Hi, my name is Tristan and I'm a queer scientific researcher.
Hello, my name is Oliver and I'm a trans guy who make videos about LGBTQIA+ people where they get to talk about anything that they want that somehow relates to them being queer. I recently met up with Tristan, who is a scientific researcher who's moved from the US to Gothenburg, Sweden.
Hi, my name is Tristan McKenzie. I'm a researcher at the University of Gothenburg. My research focuses on coastal hydrology, so I study a lot about how human impacts on land impact coastal water quality, looking at sea level rise impacts and wastewater inputs primarily. I identify as queer, and I also have experience as a trans man.
This is what his work focuses on.
A lot of my research looks at the impacts of pharmaceuticals actually coming to the coastal ocean. So basically I do a lot of work both in the field, so going out collecting water samples, and then I do some lab work and machine learning on the side, I guess, for research aspects. Other aspects of my job include student supervision and teaching.
Tristan has chosen to speak about what it's like being queer in science and academia.
I would say there's increasingly queer representation, but a lot of the attitudes in science are still that you don't bring anything else but your scientist self to work, right? So, and this impacts, I mean, everyone. I would say queer visibility is still quite limited in the sciences and academia in general. So that's one of the reasons I think it's really important to have that visibility and that representation, because it's not that we don't exist.
The lack of representation really affected Tristan.
Absolutely, because there was no one that really looked like me in the more senior roles, certainly amongst other students. Sometimes you'd be like, oh, hey, you're queer too, yes. But definitely, and actually, it really postponed my transition because I couldn't see how I could fit in to that role and that goal while also transitioning.
But after many years, he transitioned anyway, and he was received better than expected.
It's actually been really great. Everyone's been super supportive. I think that's one of the things that I was really afraid of, is that I would get some like backlash or judgment, or maybe I don't want to work with you anymore. But it's been quite the opposite. I've had a lot of support, even if people don't always understand the nuances or maybe my specific needs. They've really expressed that they want to help, or you know, how can we make this better for you?
But then he moved to Sweden and some problems arose.
I certainly encountered some issues in Sweden, because when I moved here, I still had my dead name and my gender marker was female on my passport. And there's a lot of restrictions for how you're allowed to, even in a work setting, they had to use the name that was legal. They couldn't do anything with the gender marker. That was actually quite stressful, because then I was like, well, what am I supposed to do with this? And you know, the way that it got resolved was, you know, fortunately I was able to actually change it. As a non-Swedish citizen, I could change my passport abroad and then force it to be changed in Sweden.
Academia has a strong culture surrounding names.
I would say in academic culture, our currency is really our name and our productivity. I mean, I hate to put it like that, but at the core, it's your publications and the name recognition. So with that kind of being the driver, thinking about changing one's name on past publications is really stressful, because then you're also like, well, is anyone going to recognize me anymore? I've spent all of these years trying to build up this career, and am I just going to, you know, cancel it out, never mind, start fresh, which, you know, it's already such a challenging field to get anywhere in, right? You know, that was something that I think really postponed me from doing this, and me really thinking like, well, do I have to? Can I just keep going forward as I have been? Fortunately, a few years ago, a group of trans researchers put a lot of work into talking to journals about allowing name changes for trans individuals that kind of don't have like a correction notice or any kind of, you know, indicator that it's been changed. It was certainly a lot of work to go through on the publications, and then also publicizing, well, how, you know, this is still the same person. And the thing that I really decided to do there was then, okay, if this is happening, why don't I control the narrative? Why don't I come out, be like, I'm super happy, this is still me, and you can all say whatever you want to say if you want, but you're not going to infringe on my happiness. And that I think really helped me think about how I could turn this into a positive, how I could still link the person I was before and now, and also hopefully drive some kind of social change within academic culture.
All this has taken a lot of time and energy.
I still have a couple publications that I couldn't change, despite repeated requests, which is not my favorite. But largely, I mean, within a couple of months of effort, which, I mean, and I think that's one thing that really doesn't show in my science life is how many hours it took to kind of go through this process and research and, okay, how am I going to do this? How am I going to change my name in two countries, my gender marker in two countries? How am I going to deal with this in the science way? Even like URL names had to be changed. And there's no way to fully kind of erase what has already happened, and that's not necessarily my intention, but to kind of unify this going forward, it's, I think, really important.
Tristan thinks that this really needs to be changed.
Yeah, I mean, I think just the name change process in general. So if we want to go through like the publications or like just have this be really a lot more automated, because I, even for like places where they said that it would be quite easy to do, I got a lot of editors saying, oh no, we can't do that. And then I'd be like, no, here's your policy, it's on your website. And then they would be like, oh, I guess we can do this. Like, yes, you can. Good job. So I think just more education. I'm simplifying this down to like a name, right, and a gender marker, like legal aspects. But it's also, how do you be more supportive of individuals that you work with? I said that I do a lot of field work, right? So what are the kind of field-specific concerns that might arise from maybe someone who is just starting their transition or later in their transition? Are there places that aren't safe for them to travel to? I think there needs to be a lot more dialogue about these things.
There are also other issues with being trans in academia.
So, and I would say that especially in academia, there's kind of this expectation because the jobs are so few and far in between. So you're lucky if you get a position, if you get a job, that we're kind of instructed to just take what's available regardless of where it is. And then that was never an attitude that was going to work for me, regardless of being queer or not. But it substantially limits where I'm willing to go or to live as a trans person, as a queer person, more so than I would say for, you know, certainly the average cishet white male. But it's definitely another layer that I think a lot of people don't think about. Or where are we going to put this scientific conference? Where are we going to do field work? Well, okay, can I, you know, if I get into a car accident, is my life in danger from being in the hospital, from being just trans, you know? Yeah, there's, I think, kind of with that attitude and recognizing that this has been a career limitation for myself, you know, I'm not going to be flexible in that way to not, you know, go somewhere I feel safe.
But it's not just as easy as a country being either safe or unsafe. There are nuances.
Even if culturally there's a lot of social acceptance and it can be maybe safe from that perspective, access to medical care or questioning if that will go through or not. I mean, certainly I went through this in Sweden, or restarting the kind of the process for these things, you know, it makes it so I don't necessarily want to be as mobile as maybe I would want to, you know, just from being a person. So that is certainly a consideration. I think the other thing that I was really thinking of covering is just how important it is to have mentors, role models, people in, you know, a variety of occupations or doing things or sports or, you know, whatever your hobbies, that you can say, I look like them. You know, I think that's something that's been really missing from academia and science for queer and trans people. And I guess I just want to say that, you know, we're here. We're not going anywhere.
Lastly, these are some words from Tristan to you if you want to get into science but don't see the representation.
I would say follow your dreams and find your place. Like, science isn't always the most hospitable for anyone, but there are certainly people that are willing to support trans and queer people. So just find your people and find your niche. There's certainly room.
If you enjoyed watching that video, please like, comment, subscribe, and share the video. I really appreciate you showing your love in that way. If you also want to support the channel financially, that's possible via Patreon, but really no pressure. See you next time.